Did you have a chance to affirm? Say yes.
Yes.
Yeah. One of the most valuable things we find in these opportunities is the opportunity to share one to another from our own story. And we like to say that we teach with the curricula of ourselves. And I hope you feel part of the conversation today. And I can see from watching and from listening that it's proven to be a valuable time thus far, so we're very grateful. I'm going to take a risk because I've learned that often in this work, risk is imperative. Would you say that with me? Risk is imperative. Say it, please. Risk is imperative. We must take risk. And I'm going to take a risk now that I seldom do, but I'm going to do it because I feel, and I'm teaching just this afternoon from the affect, if that's all right. I turn the camera. Oh, this is good. We're going to still face the screen and stone up and choose somebody that you want to talk to when you land. Choose someone to visit with.
This room is here.
I am very, very, very grateful. Sometimes to invite the move is a big risk, isn't it? Sometimes to invite the move is a big risk. And what I've learned from visiting in classrooms and visiting with scholars across the nation with this work is that we must sort of expand our own understanding of what we mean when we say, for this moment in time, literacy. And so in our work with districts, we often come across sort of definitions for literacy. Most districts that I'm honored to partner with would agree that literacy does change everything. And most often, some understanding of what we mean when we say literacy involves these four elements: the idea of listening and speaking and reading and writing. But our contention this afternoon, based on working with those that have keynoted today, those that have added to our time together, is that we must expand our own understanding of what we might mean when we say literacy, to stretch beyond just listening, speaking, reading, and writing. We must honor the primacy of listening and speaking. And we must understand that reading and writing are the way we broker access in our community, largely. But we almost always forget to include this idea that listening, speaking, reading, writing must be accompanied by thinking in the realm of collective agency, that we all know while we're doing this, it's about our thought, and that our thought then affords change. And it can be ourselves changing our own personal story and experience, or it can be us teaming or collaborating to make a change in our own community or the greater community. But we must think about change within the definition of literacy, so that as I'm developing as a literate being, I've learned over these last 2 years, and I'll share why in particular, that changing is a part of literacy. And I've also found that in order to truly be comfortable with every element of change, both personal and professional, thinking about teaching from the curricula of myself, this idea of personal and professional together, right, Roberto? I have to be willing to think about whether I can really engage what we're calling wholeheartedly. So just right now, with the people around you, would you talk about what you think I might have in mind when I say wholehearted living? Break that out with someone. What might that mean? Go ahead and talk a little bit. wholehearted living might be. I'm loving this, you guys. I don't want to cut it short. I need you to know that I taught kindergarten long enough that I grew to be able to hear every conversation in the room. This is true. This is so true. And when I moved to eighth grade, I regretted having the ability to hear every conversation. But as detached or participatory listener, I'm hearing some interesting elements in what you're describing when you're chatting about what we might need when we invite wholehearted living as part of our corporate understanding of what it means to be literate. So I wonder, is it all right if I, quote unquote, do a read aloud? Is that all right? Say yes. Okay.
Are we doing story time?
No, this is sort of family story time, Emerita. The idea, I mean, if I could have put everyone on the couch, I would have, but our evaluations, you know, I don't know. If we could find enough couches in the hotel, they might not invite us back. When I asked for the couch and the chairs, it was a big ask, I need you to know. I thought about just dragging them in myself, but I'm not as brave as Mert. I didn't want to disrupt their furniture. So I wonder if I could allow, would you mind thinking along with the speaker? Is that okay? Wholehearted living is about engaging with our lives from a place of worthiness. It means cultivating the courage, compassion, and connection to wake up in the morning and to think, no matter what gets done and how much is left undone, I am enough. Now, would it be all right if I read aloud again? Ma'am?
Yes.
Thank you for affording me that opportunity. This time, as you think along with the speaker, would you mind just jotting down or capturing somewhere a few important things that you hear, just in list form. Are we comfortable with that? Just a few salient key terms. Anything your heart and head would tell you to jot. Are we comfortable? Okay. Wholehearted living is about engaging with our lives from a place of worthiness. It means cultivating the courage, compassion, and connection to wake up in the morning and think, no matter what gets done and how much is left undone, I am enough. Now, one thing that we found in our work together, in PS and past, just right down the street down here with a group of folks. I've been to Pulaski, where it's my transformer school, Pulaski, and I've been to sites, I've been to West Dallas, and as I've worked with students and watched folks in action, one thing that I've seen is that often great instruction comes from a place that we hold in common. And when we think about equity of access and voice, it can be fraught with risk to try to identify what those pieces that we all hold in common might be. This is a brave conversation. When we've focused across our day to think about the rich range of diverse possibilities within the communities where we're honored to root and take part, to think about what we hold in common is a different way of thinking. I think we're all adults here today. All of you are decidedly But we're all adults, right? And all of us have some collective experience with scholarship, yes? Post-secondary, yes, or we wouldn't be in the room, right? So in that experience, I think we might have had some common experiences around note-taking. But think about the way you take notes now. Do you outline, do you list, do you Cornell, do you bullet, what do you do? Just think about that. I wonder if I were to read this small section a third time, could you take some notes while I read? Would you be willing? I'll do that then. I'll read it a third time. Wholehearted living is about engaging with our lives from a place of worthiness. It means cultivating the courage, the compassion, and connection to wake up in the morning and think, no matter what gets done and how much is left undone, I am enough. Now I'm going to invite you, folks around you, whoever you desire, take your notes, discuss your notes with a friend, a new friend, and try to recreate the text. Cool? On your mark, set, go. So let me ask you, can I have you back to say yes? Can I step out of role for a second and ask you just to join me? I'm seeking to be invitational, by the way. You see the brain compatibility that I want you to use this afternoon. It's carbo time. We gave you beer cheese soup, and then they put me on the agenda, right? So even by inviting you to come to a different space and place, I think I'm being brain compatible. What else has been good about our 10 minutes together thus far? Anything good? What makes it engaging? Trying to be inviting, trying to teach with story. Learning from Bill and from Roberto that story is where we find this, right? I love that you're calling that out. I would quantify that word with three words: choice, voice, and cause. Right? Choice, voice, and cause. Choice of how to do it, voice of your own, and worthy cause to do it. Right here, right here. Yes. Yes, yes. I'm trying to build family, yes? I'm trying to invite. I want to call you to me and us to each other. I believe this is culturally responsive. What is appropriate? We're co-crafting our culture, and we're doing it together. for her one-and-doners. The teachers that were on our work alongside us are one-and-doners. We think, I read it once, now go process it. But if something is worthy, we repeat it. So I'm trying to live out this notion of close reading, repeated reading, short chunks of worthy text, to ask and answer text-dependent questions, to invite some sort of note-taking, to engage in collaborative conversation. That was living what the literature would say is close reading right now, yes? It's also a process called text reconstruction from the work of Dr. Jana Echevarria, one of the co-creators of the SIOP model. So if we're looking at how to engage learners of linguistic diversity, and every learner owns linguistic diversity, we do, yes, then this idea of intentional redundancy and a protocol for reconstructing text is a really good thing. And I'll talk just briefly about the specific steps for those of us that go into classrooms and model or that have a flock of our own. This is an equity builder, because think of all the layers of access we created by simply being redundant and pragmatic in our invitation. Does that make sense? So as I was listening up to today, and I love this idea of knowing our why, Bill, I kind of adapted what I thought about sharing with you today, because I would be disingenuous if I didn't share my why. I've been thinking about this notion of wholehearted living in the context of whole child, whole heart, how we engage in our wholeness of being. And the quote that we read is from Dr. Brené Brown, and I think those three C's in the middle, the courage, the compassion, and the connection, might be at the heart of what is our work around equity of access and voice. But it's interesting, you know, as we, in my work, kind of come up with ways to label. That's one of the things that I do in our organization with a big team of people. Whole child, whole heart is sort of a theme for us right now. Literacy changes everything. It's sort of marketing speak for us right now. But if we just use those pieces and don't think about what they really mean, then they don't carry meaning, right? And so, this is the reason whole child, whole heart means a great deal to me just at this time. Some of you that are in relationship with us know that my wife and I recently lost our youngest son, Jordan. And Jordan's name is Jordan Ross Garcia Slade, a young Latino male from the Pacific Northwest who passed at 26. Jordan passed. He was a college student wrapping up his senior year in the leadership program at Trinity University near our home, and he had a speech and a paper due on a Friday, and he was so concerned about his voice in this leadership cadre, he was so intensely nervous on Thursday night that he went out with some friends and drank so much that he passed away, wake up in the morning. This is the story of my growth through trauma. This idea that because of loss, I am learning that I must value every conversation in a different way prior than loss. That I must see things more deeply than I did prior to loss, and that I must lift up what is good more pragmatically than I did prior to loss. And I think about how Jordan's university experience might have been different, might have been different if his team of professors who cared intensely about him were engaging him in different ways, if his mother and I were supporting him in different ways. We ask these questions in loss. I hope it's okay to say that in this loss, we're focused on thinking about courage and thinking about connection and thinking about compassion and how to be wholehearted when your heart is broken. Does that make sense? And in sharing this story with you, I do it because we can be intensely practical. What I did with the passage from Brené Brown is text reconstruction. Step one, read while the students just listen. Step two, read a second time while the kids capture key words. Read a third time while the kids take notes. Invite the learners to reconstruct the notes. A fifth step might be to compare what you did in reconstruction with the original. We didn't do that today because of time. But what made this powerful was the fact that we curated a piece of text that would resonate with our purpose at this time. Equity work requires courage, requires compassion, and requires connection. Equity work means that we leverage our own stories of growth post-trauma, of living through loss, of valuing literature in ways that function, yes, as windows, mirrors, and doors, but beyond that, out of our own experience. I've had the high honor of working with students across the grade level spectrum in these last months post-Jordan's loss. The conversation, the listening and speaking, the reading, writing, the thinking, the changing, and the wholehearted living that has come as a result of being vulnerable enough to share my story. And in that vulnerability to model that all are welcome to share their own stories has changed my work as a teacher. Now, how these changes have come can be sort of conceived in some very concrete ways. I've been thinking about some possible social and emotional learning capacities. And what I've recognized is that in the literature, there is deep cultural bias within the SEL literature. So what I need to invite is, from the community where I'm honored to be rooted, are these the capacities that we would want corporately to lift up and develop one in another? And to be culturally relevant, I learned this morning, means that my work reflects the thought and experience of the community where I'm rooted. And so, if I were thinking just of Jordan today, there are some elements, even on the screen behind me, that I would lift up because he exemplified them. And some where, if I had the opportunity now, I would work differently than I have or did in life. Does that make sense? So I'm thinking about how we curate this list to reflect and flow out of these spaces and places where we're honored to work. And we've kind of been thinking about this very formally. We've been thinking about two elements as the growing space for what we would lift up as social and emotional capacity. So we're calling this the power of we. What are our we beliefs as a community of learners? And I'm engaging learners across the country, identifying that which we think needs to be in our soil in order to grow. And this We want to love reading. We do this to build knowledge. We inspire confidence one in another. We believe learning is our own. We learn through modeling and practice, and we respect and value each other. And so these sorts of tenets are underneath what we're working on. This is the kind of culture that is involved when you bring post-traumatic growth into your PLC, or into your job life, or into your rug time with 9-year-olds. And this is powerful work. I can ground it in a number of resources in the literature, but I'd much rather trust the 9-year-old scholars that pulled it out and labeled it. Now, this is the work of Dr. Doug Fisher, who we're honored to partner with. We thought about, what's the power of we? What do we believe in together? That's the soil, those are those classroom cultural conditions that we'll build. And then what we've realized is the power of me. The power of the individual in that literacy growth community. And we're thinking about these me statements as habits. That which we value, we repeat, is one of our tenets in the communities of learners that we're honored to work with, where entrance ramps reach every learner. So we have voice, choice, and wonder, as Merck would say, or pause, I've been thinking about today. Merck, I've been thinking since we've been last together that there's a place for grace in that list. The idea that approximations are welcome in our culture of learners, right? That we can make an attempt, and if we have outcomes that are different than we thought we might, we can recalibrate and move forward. So what are we doing with these habits and these cultural pieces? We're crafting spaces for collaborative, culturally responsive, social and emotional capacity identification. We're not taking just a castle list. We're not pulling from the most recent book. We're taking a castle list and a recent book and an article and a thought leader, and then we're engaging with our learners to talk about and think about what capacities might we want to focus our attention on. Does that make sense? So we're creating an awareness of the capacities that we need to focus on through collaboration with our learners. We're also creating spaces for these we and me tenets. That idea of our classroom culture being this is what we believe, and those I statements, the habits that we build. This is important work. And we're also finally thinking about how we can curate text for that Windows work, for that mirror work, and for that door or gateway work. So what can this look like? I wonder if we could just take the last few minutes we have together and move into some work that we've been doing with some students. As I change my screen, would you share around you, what's one thought? I love the question. What are you sitting with right now? Just share what you're sitting with right now. Go for it.
Thank you.
shaping the classroom culture, and we're identifying the social and emotional capacities we're focused on, and we're thinking about the habits we want to build, then the last piece might be to be very intentional about the text environments that we ask kids to work in. And just to close our time, I just wanted to be with you a half hour today. I hope that's okay. I want to stay on schedule. Just to close our time, I want to take us to a piece of literature that's 20 years old that McGraw-Hill doesn't own. And it's okay. From the work of Patricia Polacco, Pinkin Say, a seminal work around two Civil War soldiers. One of the most exciting interactions I've had with 11-year-old people in the last month has been to take this text and have the learners engage in a conversation about the social and emotional learning capacities they noticed in the two characters who lead the text, Paint and Say. Now, we won't read the text. We'll honor Polacco's work as both illustrator and author. Here you see Paint leaving his family to go serve in the Civil War to fight for the Union. Here you see Say leaving his family to go to the same war. And then as battle ensues, you see Pink finding Say injured in a field, and then you see Pink intervening, literally working to rescue, to carry at great duress, to bring his fellow soldier to his home, to introduce him to his own mother, who then nurses Say, has great relationship with her son, Pink, the relationship that they share over time. And then there's this interaction where they're walking the ruin of the plantation where Pink has been enslaved. And I would just read this piece of text, the 11-year-olds that helped me curate Polacco's great work, chose this as the page of the text that most exemplifies Pink's specific social and emotional learning capacities. So to close, let's just honor this one passage. If you could listen in a way that would help you identify the strengths that Pink brings to the interaction. Is that okay? We've created a culture, right? Even in these few minutes, we have. We've set up some habits. We'll read with purpose over and over. We'll speak to each other, yes. And we've also included social and emotional capacity development as a part of literacy, along with wholehearted living and listening, speaking, reading, writing, and thinking so that we can be changers. I'll read. After a few more days, I could walk a little steadier, but still needed help. This is the voice of the Say. Pink took me out by the big house and walked me through it. Weren't much left of it, really. It was mostly burned out. Master Ailey had a library full of books right here, he said. He taught me to read, even though it was against the law. He must have been a good man, I said. More bad than good, Say. Sometimes I think he just liked being read to. There was this book of poetry, Say, that was this thick. Every night, I read out loud to him from that book. I love this part. I bless this house because of all those beautiful books. But I cursed it, too, for what it stood for. we walked a bit forward, further. To be born a slave is a heap of trouble, say. But after Ailey taught me to read, even though he owned my person, I knew that nobody ever could really own me. You feel hot, Pink, I said. Lord, I think you are as sick as me. Let me fetch you back to the house. I'll be fine, boy. Just a little tired, that's all. I'll be ready to fight, though. I'll be ready to fight. Let's honor this beautiful piece just by saying to each other, what social and emotional strength do you see in me? We make our conversation corporate. Would anyone be willing to share what you're speaking of? What are you talking about? Anybody? Anyone? It must have been worth our dip into the literature, right? So let's be brave enough to share. Anyone? He's very self-aware in that he can recognize his experience of the house, both the good and the bad. That's profound. To find the gifts in loss, to find the gifts in bondage. Any other thoughts about Pink's social and emotional capacity? Thank you, Bert. No matter the entrapment, he was a free man. There's so much there around the power of story, yes? Anything else you would lift up? Yes. And as you mine this text, you see bias that's complex and layered. It's a courageous text to unpack. It's okay to lift thorny texts up, isn't it? Yes. Thank you, Mert. Mert's question was, before we close, could we say a little bit about text curation? Part of the work that we do as an organization is to curate into both classroom library, to select authentic texts that would sit now just at the center of genre-focused text sets across all reading levels. A big part of that work, Mert, making sure that we have multiple voices in that curation protocol. And oftentimes we work with small task groups, and each group collaborates to bring forward text that might reflect a particular theme. Often we work from inquiry questions as a guide. And then when we come together to build that classroom library, or to develop what we might include in an anthology or something like that, all of those multiple voices from multiple groups are sort of taken into account. Often what comes up for us is, and I hate to use this term, but it is, a criteria that is inclusive of both quantitative and qualitative measures. So we're thinking about the veracity of the text, we're thinking about the power of the arc of the story when we're in literary text, the accuracy of the information when we're in informational text, but we're always about curating. And the other thing that I would say is that in all of the resources that we're working to develop now, we're thinking about that curation as an ongoing conversation. We used to kind of curate, and this was the canon. Or we pulled all the third grade texts together, and these were the exemplars. But sort of a digital acumen and access allows us to build a collection that is indeed a living collection, so that we can pull out and put in. Does that make sense? Was it worth your time to come to the rug for story time?
Yes.
Got some takeaways? Okay. We want to, oh, you say one. And the most interesting conversation about the pen that I wear Jordan on my shoulder, and I was talking to some 11-year-old people, and they always ask me, who, what, where. They wanted to make their own pins. So I think it's powerful that we all have a story, right? So we did. We'll go back to our team.